The Honourable Member for Mount Royal.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to address Bill C-54, the Not Criminally Responsible Reform Act, which would change how the Canadian justice system deals with accused found not criminally responsible, or NCR, on account of mental disorder. It may seem like deja vu for some that I'm speaking again on this issue. Indeed, as Minister of Justice and Attorney General of Canada, I stood in this place to introduce the legislation that reformed this system, legislation that, I might add, passed with the support of all parties in 2005. I was proud of the legislation that we introduced on NCR accused because it adopted an evidence-based approach that incorporated the guidance of the Supreme Court of Canada, the expertise of justice and health professionals, and reports of standing committees of the House on this matter. Regrettably, the same cannot be said of the bill before us. In the matter of C-54, the government's approach and rhetoric appear to be grounded more in fear and stigma than in the facts and evidence. Let me begin by reminding us all of the scope of this bill. NCR accused are neither found guilty nor innocent. As the Supreme Court explains, this regime supplements the traditional guilt-innocence dichotomy of the criminal law with a new alternative for NCR accused, an alternative of assessment to determine whether the person poses a continuing threat to society, coupled with an emphasis on providing opportunities to receive appropriate treatment. NCR accused, Mr. Speaker, account for less than 1% of accused persons annually. In evaluating the NCR regime and determining whether reform is needed, it is important to keep these facts in mind. Yet on the day this bill was tabled, the former Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Justice and currently the Associate Minister of National Defence appeared on CBC and said, with respect to the recidivism rate of NCR accused, and I quote, "I'm not aware that there are any particular statistics available on that. I'm not sure that this is what it's all about," unquote. This is a particularly puzzling statement, given that the Supreme Court, in the case from which I just cited, Wincombe, British Columbia, found that, and I quote, "Research shows that NCR accused are no more likely than their convicted counterparts to commit any offence, let alone a violent offence, upon release." While that particular case is from 1999, more recent statistics are available, but they are not favourable to the government's case. Indeed, this statement by the Parliamentary Secretary was, in essence, an admission that the government has eschewed empirical evidence in the drafting of this bill, which aims expressly to make it more difficult to release NCR accused in the name of public safety. Yet if legislation is to protect the public against a particular threat, information regarding the extent of that threat is fundamental. Otherwise, we are legislating based on myth, gut instinct, and stereotyping, which the NCR regime sought specifically to guard against with respect to the mentally ill. This bill is dealing with less than 10% of a population that is already less than 1% of all those criminally accused in Canada. You would think that for all the hype over this legislation, it would be targeted at a large group of Canadians, not less than 0.1%. There's no doubt, Madam Speaker, that the rarity of the occurrence is of little importance to those who are victimized and the horror that they have experienced, and certain efforts to refine our NCR regime may well be worthwhile. In fact, C-54 does contain some measures that are reasonable and worthy of support, such as keeping victims' families better informed and prohibiting perpetrators from contacting victims after their release. Yet the government's overstatement of the problem and heavy-handed response to it risks doing more harm than good. The high-risk designation, Mr. Speaker, combined with tripling the time period between reviews from 1 year to 3, may cause NCR inmates to remain in custody long after successful treatment. Such an outcome would be unacceptable, given that, as the Supreme Court has stressed, NCR accused have not been convicted of a crime. Indeed, as the Court has stated, and I quote, "The NCR accused is to be treated with the utmost dignity and afforded the utmost liberty compatible with his or her situation. The NCR accused is not to be punished, nor is the NCR accused to languish in custody," unquote. Accordingly, C-54 could lead to charter claims, both with respect to the Section 7 right to life, liberty and security of the person, the Section 9 guarantee that everyone has the right to be arbitrarily detained or imprisoned, and we could see Section 15 challenges as there is a prohibition against discrimination on the basis of mental disability. Yet again, the government is seeking to enact legislation that will invite protracted, inexpensive, and avoidable constitutional litigation. And may I add parenthetically that ever the optimist, I await the minister's report of charter inconsistency pursuant to Section 4.1 of the Department of Justice Act. But beyond the litigation risk, Mr. Speaker, detaining more NCRQs for longer periods of time gives rise to the very practical problem of where these individuals will reside while in treatment. For this reason, I have asked the government for details about the capacity of the mental health institutions in which NCRQs are placed and about any plans to increase that capacity, as well as any analysis that has been performed of C-54's potential consequences in this regard. It is by no means clear that our system is, at present, capable of dealing with greater numbers of NCRQs institutionalized for longer periods of time, and we risk complicating their recovery by straining the resources of the institutions and the individuals that are treated. That potential strain and resulting decrease in the effectiveness of such institutions, combined with the possibility that NCRQs could be detained for years even after successful treatment, might mean that mentally ill accused will be less likely to plead NCR as a result of this bill. We would therefore find ourselves with even more mentally ill people in our prison system, and I'm sure that I do not have to remind members of the tragic consequences of housing people with mental disorders in prisons rather than medical facilities. There are consequences for the inmates, as was demonstrated by the heart-wrenching videos of Ashley Smith, and there are consequences for public safety, that which the government says is their primary concern that it underpins this bill. When mentally ill people are returned untreated into society after serving a prison sentence, they pose a far greater danger than NCRQs who have been treated by medical professionals and evaluated by experts. For this reason, I introduced an amendment to last year's Omnibus Crime Bill that would have allowed offenders to receive mental health treatment prior to incarceration, as is already done in cases of drug addiction. Regrettably, the Conservatives rejected this amendment. Yet, Mr. Speaker, the best way of minimizing the potential that someone with a mental illness will commit a violent act, and therefore the best way of protecting the public, again that which appears to be the objective as stated by the government for this legislation, is to ensure effective treatment for the mentally ill. This brings me to the next section of my remarks, in which I will discuss ways of minimizing the risk of violence by the mentally ill without resorting to punitive, counterproductive, and constitutionally suspect measures which underpin this legislation. Parliament must encourage and facilitate, Mr. Speaker, timely and effective treatment not only for NCRQs, but especially for people in the early stages of mental illness whose conditions can be treated effectively. Indeed, according to the Schizophrenia Society of Canada, the key is early identification, intervention, and treatment. To that end, we could train people who work with youth to recognize the initial symptoms of psychosis, since many psychoses develop in adolescence, and we could help expand the reach of first episode psychosis clinics, institutions specifically designed to help young patients and their families deal with mental illness in its early stages. Sadly, however, too many people wait years before receiving treatment, sometimes because their symptoms go unrecognized and often because they fear the very stigma associated with mental disease. It is therefore vital for parliamentarians to set the example by combating that stigma through our words and deeds. I have no trouble understanding the fear and frustration that many Canadians feel when certain NCRQs are returned to society. And I appreciate the horror that victims have felt in this regard and the trauma that is thereby experienced. But we will never protect the public by letting fear outweigh facts as a basis for legislation or having a punitive approach overtake the need for prevention. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Questions and comments? Question et commentaire?